Hachette Audio presents Long Drawn Out Trip by Gerald Scarfe, read by Philip Franks. Introduction. I was interviewing my friend Roger Waters for the Pink Floyd book I was writing, when he suddenly rose from his chair and announced he had an appointment to play golf and had to go. I hadn't quite finished with the interview, and sensing this, Roger said, "If you want any more memories..." "Yes," I said expectantly. "Just fucking make it up." Well, I've not made up any of the following, but maybe it would have been more interesting if I had. History is bunk, they say, depending on who wrote it and from what point of view or what side. We all know if you have four people in a room together who witness a murder, when interviewed later individually, they will probably give four differing accounts. So autobiographies are bound to be approximate, and the longer the time lapse, the sketchier the memory. I've written about my life and times as an artist, and how I became what I am. I'm told that readers will be interested to know about my beginnings, what formed me. So this is an account of my childhood, where they say most people are formed. Give me a child until he is seven, and I'll give you the man. And what happened after. What in my childhood, background, and environment turned me into the artist I have become. What has given me the reputation of a cruel, grotesque, and satirical artist with a black view of life? Well, if one scientific theory is to be believed, none of the above. Environment, home life, and schooling have had no effect. It's all in my DNA. It's entirely and totally that which decides what I am, absolutely nothing else. But I'm not so sure. It's interesting which memories survive. In my case, often because they are moments of extreme pain. Watching boys pull the legs off spiders in the school playground, and cruelly trying to do it myself. Slipping my hand into my father's on a family walk during a visit he made to see us, and burning it on his cigarette. And another time, walking home tearful and soggy in dripping grey flannel trousers after falling in the river while tadpoling. I made a bow and arrow. I shot it and hit a small boy in the eye. I was so scared. I thought I'd blinded him. He was okay. But all these years later, the feelings of guilt and fear come rushing back when I think of him. Writing an autobiography and talking constantly about oneself can be tantamount to blowing one's own trumpet. In trying to give a correct history, I've had to include the good times and the praise I've had. That can feel self-promoting and big-headed sometimes, whereas recounting the bad times can seem self-deprecating and honest. I've tried to ignore this and to put in facts that I think might be interesting, whether good or bad. It is, above all, an account of my professional life as an artist. My private life is shared with others, but I do not want to hurt my nearest and dearest by exposing them to scrutiny. I have a wonderful wife, Jane, and four children. Two beautiful daughters, Katie and Araminta, and two handsome sons, Alexander and Rory. We devastatingly lost my third son, Rupert, to illness 3 years ago. I do not intend to invade their privacy by writing about them in this autobiography. Likewise, my six grandchildren, Ella, Iggy, Abel, May, Ava, and Freddie, will not be appearing, and I will also not be embarrassing any of my ex-partners. Inevitably, Jane's name appears from time to time in the book, but these minimal references in no way reflect the closeness we have shared in our nearly 50 years together, or the huge influence she has had and continues to have on my life and work. So, this is a memoir of some of my childhood days and my progress through the art, theatre, and film world. To avoid disappointment, it's probably best for me to come clean at the beginning. I'm not a recovering alcoholic, although I do have a bar named after me. I'm not a drug addict, although I have dabbled in drugs recreationally, opium in Vietnam, coke in my rock and roll days. Drugs have a different connotation to me. They invoke memories of illness. So drugs I have had aplenty, for the wretched asthma I have suffered from my whole life. I've been asked if the cocktail of drugs I have been taking for over 80 years including the speed-like ephedrine and adrenaline of my childhood, both of which made me feel unpleasantly high, and the powerful, effective, and life-changing steroids of my adulthood, could have affected my perceptions and distorted my vision either then or now. I've never asked a medical person. I'm not sure they would know anyway, but it's an interesting thought. Why write an autobiography? I'm not sure. Sort of like a tidying up, putting it all together in one drawer. It's fascinating to look back and see how much one has done, and also how little. How lucky I've been, and yet how many opportunities I've let slide by. How many wrong tributaries I have taken, and how, on other occasions, I have landed on my feet by sheer serendipity. Very little of it has been planned. I've almost tumbled from one job to another. I have never kept a diary. Many of the memories I have assembled here come from rifling through what press cuttings, articles, and catalogues I have. But the strongest memories are brought back by looking at my drawings, most of which I have kept. Each one triggers the memory of when it was drawn and why, and how I felt at that time. Although an Englishman working in Britain, I have always felt an outsider, an onlooker, a recorder. As a child, I was lonely and shy, perhaps even prudish. I found that I communicated with others better by drawing my pictures. As you will notice, words are not my métier. My education was poor, if not non-existent, especially in my younger years, when asthma wrecked my schooling. I will try to put words together as I would a painting. To make a picture, using adjectives as colours. I have written all of this autobiography in longhand. Being something of a Luddite, I have never mastered computers. I am computer illiterate. It is not a matter of principle, simply one of laziness. I have never had to make the effort, as Jane and my assistant, Julie, are both completely on top of the game and do it all for me. This does not mean computers are not involved in my work. Many of my drawings are composed on the computer. On paper, I may draw two figures, for instance, and Julie scans them separately into Photoshop, and we put them into a scene together, perhaps also adding a sky I've painted earlier or other elements. Today, the internet is incredibly useful for whizzing drawings around the globe. In 1966, I was in a chaotic post office in Saigon, filling in barely understandable forms in an effort to get a large parcel of drawings back to England. Utter confusion. I thought I'd said goodbye to them forever, but they made it. Now, a press of a button, and they're there in a flash. But for this book, it had to be all handwritten, which is limiting. Words, sentences have to be added by writing over the top of existing copy if I want to change anything. Tolstoy managed it, no comparison suggested. Or rather, Mrs. Tolstoy did. And many writers still prefer to work in longhand, establishing a tactile contact with the page to help see where they have been and where they went wrong. The whole history of the piece is always there, so in my case it's very like drawing, battling through the mistakes and imposing the correct drawing on top, always aware of the path taken. The process of drawing can be wonderful when it works, ideas flowing, an urgency and necessity to get them down before they evaporate. But beware those days when nothing, nothing, nothing will happen. No wonder we believe in the muse. I end up trying to trick myself into working, rushing it, sidling up to it, caressing it. But nothing happens. The pen won't work. The ink is too thick. My hand is like a steel claw or a mountainous piece of dough. There is no connection between my hand and my brain. The work stuttering and spluttering onto the paper. The nib snaps. It's hell. Damn. Where did it go? It was here a minute ago. Incidentally, people often ask me if I think my drawings change anything. My answer is, not a jot. So why do I bother? I don't know. I feel I must cry out. Perhaps it can raise the public conscience, prick the public nerve. But the poor public nerve is numb with bombardments from all quarters. We sit with great heaped plates of food in front of us, watch television pictures of the dying and the starving, and feel a momentary pang of guilt which moves on when the pictures change. Then we go to the fridge to see what we can have for pudding. Chapter 1. Nightmares. I know so little about my parents. When they were alive, I didn't think to ask. I recently found out that my mother was not Welsh, as I had believed, but had only been brought up in Wales, in Radnorshire, where her father was headmaster of New Radnor School. I have a book, John Halifax, Gentleman, a prize given to my mother when she was at the school in 1913 as a 5-year-old girl. An illuminated plate inside on the first page reads, "Second prize, awarded to Edna Gardner for regular attendance," and was signed by John Gardner, head teacher. A slight whiff of nepotism there, perhaps. I was told that every summer the girls of New Radnor looked forward with excitement to the arrival of the 4 Scarfe brothers, who regularly spent their summer holidays in that area. It was there, one year, that my father had met my mother after riding down from London on his motorbike. On one of these trips, he lost control of the motorbike and knocked out his 2 front teeth on the New Radnor Bridge. My family home was in Swiss Cottage, North London, at 57 Goldhurst Terrace, to be precise. The house is still there today. As always, on revisiting a place you knew as a child, everything now seems so much smaller. I was born not far away in a private nursing home in St. John's Wood, a well-to-do area, on the 1st of June 1936. I suppose we were middle class. My mother had been a schoolteacher before her marriage. My father, Reginald, a Londoner, spent all of his civilian life in banking. I was their first child, and my brother would not be born until after the war, nearly 9 years later. I was always told as a child that I had a weak chest. From the age of 1, I suffered from chronic asthma. When I reached the age of about 5, I would try to pretend I didn't have asthma so that other children would not see me as different. I inevitably did feel very different, and it was a terrible strain, trying to look as if I were breathing normally. A severe asthma attack is a horrible thing to observe. The sufferer, his shoulders heaving, gasps for every breath as though it is his last. It is truly frightening, and as a child I would see the fear on other people's faces as they thought I was about to die. The nights were the worst. I dreaded them. So many were spent dark-eyed and haunted, my dry chest heaving, propped up on rigid arms to ease my breathing, waiting for the night to end, waiting for the blackbird to sing. She signalled the dawn. It was a relief when daylight crept through the window, and still gasping for breath, in the morning light I could draw and read, listen to the radio, or watch the occasional bird through the window. During this period I became fascinated with puppets, toy theatres, and Meccano working models. I made umpteen glove puppets, string puppets, figures out of plasticine, with scenery, and gave shows for myself. One day I felt delirious with excitement and knew for sure I would be doing this type of thing in the grown-up world. But then it could have been the drugs. I did do the same thing later in my career, but the puppets were 30 feet high and the theatres and actors real. One of my favourite books was Winky Pop the Gnome. My father thought it was a huge joke and called me Winky Pop. Perhaps I had a fixation on gnomes, but one day when we were out shopping, I saw a porcelain gnome, about 2 feet high, for sale, a garden ornament. I so desperately wanted to own this ghastly gnome with his shiny green coat and pointed red hat. My parents really didn't want to buy or own it, but I pleaded, and they gave in and bought it. We carried it home to Goldhurst Terrace. I was so excited. We were going to put it in the back garden on the flagstone terrace. I wanted to hold it, but my parents said I would drop it and it would smash, and then I would be sorry. But I begged, saying no, I wouldn't drop it. Eventually, my father carefully put the gnome in my arms. I don't know exactly what came over me, but I had this feeling of wondering what would happen if it did fall. I purposely opened my arms and let him slip. I know I did it on purpose, but why, I don't know. He smashed into smithereens, and I cried my eyes out. I had destroyed the very thing I desired. Naturally, the imminent prospect of war produced a great feeling of unease everywhere. My parents must have done what they could to hide their feelings of dread, but I, as a small, anxious child, picked it up. We were still living in Goldhurst Terrace when war was declared in September 1939. The German air raids on London began in 1940. Like wolves in the night, the eerie howling of the air raid sirens struck fear into all stomachs, and citizens scurried to the shelters. The doodlebugs with their noisy engines whizzed overhead. When that engine cut out and stopped, as it was designed to do, the air was full of fear. Without the power of the engine, it dropped earthwards, full of death and explosives, onto the roofs below. Where would it land? Everyone held their breath. Whose lives would be finished? Whose would never be the same again? We had a corrugated iron air raid shelter at the bottom of the garden. It was never used, often full of rainwater, and, I can see now, completely useless. But it was a great place to play. Sweet are the uses of adversity. Whenever the siren sounded and the bombs began to fall, we went down and sat in the cellar. But I was more frightened of the wolf someone had told me lived and was hiding down there than I was of Hitler and his Luftwaffe. I was also terrified of the claustrophobic Mickey Mouse gas mask I sometimes had to wear in that cellar. The government had thought that by sticking a couple of Mickey Mouse ears onto a repellent rubber gas mask, children would be tricked into enjoying it. Absolutely not. To a young asthmatic child who was short of breath, it was a suffocating nightmare. I could not breathe. I thought I would die. When I was a boy, Dad's lead soldiers would be brought out of large cardboard boxes on special occasions. They belonged to him and his three brothers, but were always kept in our house. Tanks, gun carriages, infantry, cavalry, etc. We would set them out in ranks along the top of an old oak chest, and then put them away again. I was far too young, and they were far too precious for me to play with alone. Later, I learned that lead is not good for you. My father was called up and enlisted in the Royal Air Force. He wasn't Biggles. He didn't fly aircraft, but flew a desk, as they used to say. The RAF were the glamour boys of the forces, also known disparagingly as Brill Cream Boys, after the glutinous hair cream that plastered the hair onto the scalp and gave the short back and sides hairstyle a slick look. In 1940, my father was posted to an RAF base in Cardiff, and my mother and I went with him. Not long after the move to Cardiff, it was to be my first day of school. On that day, my mother woke me before dawn, and standing me on the kitchen table, dressed me in my new school uniform by flickering candlelight because of the blackout. I felt apprehensive. In the soft darkness, I imagined what school would be like. There would be lots of new friends, I was told. Lots of games to play. It would be fun. Then my father took me on the crossbar of his bicycle, downhill through the dark streets towards the school. I was miserable. It was horrible. I had not thought that I would ever have to leave home. I wet myself in assembly and felt horrific shame. My asthma was bad and my attendance worse. My one distinction at that school was that at the age of 5, I became renowned for drawing the Welsh dragon. I had already found that drawing made a difference. It lifted me and made me feel special. I had discovered something only I could do, something that others, including teachers, would praise me for. Great excitement ran through the school one day. A Jerry had been shot down in Cardiff. We missed the plane crash itself, but watched the pilot float silently and gently down, swinging from side to side under his white parachute. He landed in the allotments among the vegetables. 6 or 7 men ran forward wielding spades and gardening forks, but he stood up, offering no resistance, and was led silently away. He was very young, apparently. "We shall fight them in the hills, on the beaches, and among the runner beans." Occasionally, other disasters of war touched our lives in Cardiff. One evening, I heard my father tell my mother he had seen an airman cycling across the runway. Dad said that somehow he'd cycled into a taxiing plane's propeller and was chopped into bits. Naturally, these stories stay in the mind. Throughout this period, I continued to suffer badly from asthma attacks and regularly had to go to hospital. "There will be lots of toys," coaxed my parents. But hospital was frightening, and visiting hours were short. Sometimes my parents would walk across the fields at the back of the hospital to wave to me from behind a wire fence. Misery. I was in an adult ward. The cleaning lady looked like a witch. I had to humour her. The man in the bed opposite threw me a slab of toffee because I was crying. It missed the bed and slid into the fluff underneath. The witch gave it to me. I smiled at her. Better to keep in with her. You never know. By the way, the promised toys were not that great. Perhaps because of these prolonged absences from school and my scant experience of socializing with other children, I was very shy, blushed easily, and found it almost impossible to talk in public. Through most of my early childhood, I spent much time alone with my mother and was never really encouraged to make conversation. Adults tended to talk above me and over me. Sitting in the back seat of my father's car, I heard my grandfather say, "The lad doesn't say much, Reg." This stung me at the time, again making me feel not normal and cut off, but my father stoutly defended me, saying, "No, but Gerald thinks a lot." I did think a lot, and worry a lot. Dad was right. There followed a succession of schools as we moved around the country. My parents put me into the nearest one, regardless of quality, so that should I get an asthma attack, they'd be near at hand. At one school, they started algebra while I was ill. When I returned, I had no idea what the teacher was talking about, and no one bothered to explain it to me. When I was 6, my father was posted to Ludlow in Shropshire, where we lived over a pub. The pub owned an Alsatian, who slept under my bed and scratched his back on the underside of the mattress. Not great for my asthma, I learned later. Although I have memories of playing mothers and fathers with the girl who lived next door, and afterwards letting her have a go on my tricycle, I had few friends, and any I did make lost interest because I was never at school, and they found it boring to visit someone who was bedridden, coughing and spluttering. More often I was to be found in solitary pursuits. One day I tempted fate by walking under the belly of a grazing horse as a dare set by myself. Fear and excitement pricking the back of my neck as I walked around behind his back legs, which could have kicked hell out of me. And then, when I got away with it, walking under his belly to see if I could get away with it again, and then once more to make sure. That day I found a beautiful horseshoe and had it taken away by a bigger boy. I had always been good at drawing, so in my isolation I took to it more and more. And it became my method of communication with the world. It would exorcise bad thoughts and allowed me to make my own world. I could spend hours engrossed in a drawing and not notice the time pass by. I still can. I remember everyone sang, "Bless 'em all, the long and the short and the tall," as my father, the only man in uniform, carried me on his shoulders into an air raid shelter when the siren rang out. My mother and I felt very proud. Sure that the song was sung for Dad. I watched an army exercise on the wooded banks of the River Teem in the shadow of Ludlow Castle. A mock battle with Tommies versus Tommies dressed up as Germans. A German fell off the bridge into the water. The Tommies won. This made me and everyone around me happy. We had triumphed. All the Germans were either captured or dead. This play-acting of victory over the enemy was the next best thing to the real thing. Around 1943, my father was sent on another posting to Shaftesbury. My mother and I followed to the comparative safety and bliss of the Dorset countryside, where the two of us would walk down golden brown country lanes in the autumn sunshine, collecting acorns for pigs as part of the war effort, and eating dried eggs and dried bananas. My mother saved all of the family's butter ration to build me up. I hated it. I preferred margarine. I watched my father playing the double bass in the RAF band at a Christmas dance at Motcombe House, a grand stately home in the park where he was stationed. Afterwards, I waited for my turn to get a present from Father Christmas by the Christmas tree, watching the presents go, one by one, only to find I was the one child who had been forgotten. My father blamed the sergeant, who he claimed didn't like him. This was the last time we followed my father on one of his postings, as he then went up to Inverness in Scotland, I think around 1944. It was felt it was too far for my mother and I to travel to be with him, so we went to live with my mother's parents, who were now living in Kidderminster. I didn't see very much of my father during this period, as it was difficult for him to get leave. My grandparents' house was in St. John's Street, a street of modest Victorian two-story houses, but theirs was the big house at the far end of the road. There was a large garden with a grand drive that opened through double gates onto the road. On the drive was a wrought-iron garden seat, from which I had fallen at a very early age and gashed a hole in my cheek. I still bear the slight scar today. My mother was convinced the wrought-iron arm of the seat had pierced right through my cheek. It hadn't, but I can recall her panic. The house was large, but not enormous. At the foot of the stairs in the hall was a series of bells set on curly springs, which had at one time been used to summon servants. Unfortunately, we had none, so they lay silent. Years later, I went back to look for the house for a TV programme, but it was no longer there. A motorway runs straight through the living room. My grandfather, white-haired, distant and stern, was now a retired headmaster, and apart from his weekly trips out to play billiards, seemed to spend most of the time in his study, which was a no-go area. He is a hazy figure in my memory, and had very little to do with me. He would not allow my grandmother to water the garden because it was a waste of water. He always stuck to the rules, and there were wartime measures in place to save water at that time. She and my mother would do it anyway during his afternoon nap. I was woken up one night and taken to see my grandfather, who was very ill. There was a strange atmosphere in the room, people crying, I think. I was taken back to my bed, and shortly afterwards, my mother came to tell me he had gone. "Gone where?" I said. She tried to explain. There was no escaping the war, and many Americans were stationed in Kidderminster, which was exciting for us 10-year-olds. And, I started to understand, for the older girls, who found their uniforms attractive, among other things. These American soldiers were said to be overpaid, oversexed, and overhere. With a great effort, I forced myself to pluck up the courage to ask a Yank, "Have you got any gum, chum?" The boys at school had told me how they did it. He knew the drill, reached into his jacket pocket, and handed me a pack of Wrigley's spearmint. At the end of St. John Street was a prisoner of war camp called Wolverley, a converted factory in which Italian prisoners of war were interred. Its large wooden double gate was permanently open. It was clear that none of the Italian POWs would try or even wanted to escape. They were quite happy working on the local farms. So much better than fighting for the deluded braggart Mussolini and his evil pal Hitler. One day, I walked to the camp and plucked up even more courage to ask an Italian POW to give me a torch. All the other boys had. He told me to go to a side window and passed it through the wire mesh of his open prison. "Escapa, escapa," he said, and I ran for it with my prized torch. My mother told me that as it was wartime, toys were scarce, and Father Christmas would not be leaving much that year. I was disappointed, but on Christmas morning I found Santa had left me a model farm with toy animals, cows, sheep, and ducks, a little farmhouse, a pigsty. Something I later learned my father had spent many long hours making out of discarded cardboard boxes. There was a mirror for a duck pond, which I thought was very clever. Paper was scarce during the war, so being a prolific artist, always drawing and hungry for something to draw on, I covered every scrap of paper on both sides with sketches. My father would bring me ruled account books with a red line down one side from his RAF barracks, which I filled. I made a drawing of a housewife at the sink washing the dishes, while a louche-looking Yank lounged in the doorway casually smoking. Mainly, I drew scenes from Disney films, but I don't think I had a sense at that early point that art would be my vocation. Everybody said I was a good artist, but it didn't strike me as anything lasting or significant. None of my drawings from that period have survived. I don't think my parents were sentimental about my work. Maybe because of our nomadic lifestyle, moving from one address to another, we had to travel light. One thing I did cherish was my collection of cigarette cards. Some of the grown-ups in the family, including my father, smoked, and most packets of cigarettes in those days, far from carrying a death warning, enclosed a cigarette card, an encouragement to smoke on as heavily as possible. These would be pictures of famous sportsmen or film stars, and children found them highly collectible. They would be swapped by the boys at school. If you wanted a particular footballer to complete your set, you might have to give three or more of your cards in exchange in order to get it. My favourite cards were called Howlers. Beautifully drawn, they dealt with popular misconceptions in terrible jokes, which I thought were quite clever at the time. Julius Caesar was a very strong man and threw a bridge across the Rhine. Queen Elizabeth I was thin and pale, but she was a stout participant. An artist is a man with long hair who can't sell anything. At school, there was a game we played with them. The cards were flicked towards a wall, and the person whose card finished closest to the wall won all the flicked cards. I became quite good at this and amassed a vast collection of assorted cards. The playing fields of the local grammar school were at the end of St. John Street. Through the railings, I could see the boys playing rugby. They seemed different creatures to those in my school, more confident and with very loud voices. My mother told me that that school was where she would like me to go. Mother had always put much emphasis on being well-spoken and well-brought up. My parents' efforts in this regard exhausted me. My father always raised his hat to ladies. I'm not sure whether that is politically incorrect these days. I don't wear a hat, but I no longer see those who do doffing theirs. I do still rise to my feet when a female comes into the room, and my mother always told me to hold the door open for ladies. The main problem was that I was speaking with what they perceived to be a terrible Brummy accent, which should have been of no surprise, since I was going to school in Kidderminster, where everyone spoke with a Midlands accent. I was trying to be like my friends and fit in. Even now, my wife tells me I sometimes tend to imitate or adopt the accent of the person I'm talking to. I don't feel I'm being patronizing. It's more an effort to communicate. I was quiet and shy, and, ironically, to my schoolmates, I still sounded posh, and so felt even more like an outsider. I tended to befriend those who also felt themselves to be underdogs, and became close to two boys, Dharam Das and Heinz Katschke. We were all outsiders for different reasons, which drew us together. I didn't even like the name Gerald. Most of my friends had much more down-to-earth Christian names, and Gerald seemed to be toffee-nosed. I still prefer Jerry today. "I don't know what's the matter with you, Scarfe," said one teacher when I was in my early teens, reinforcing this feeling of being different. "Why are you always drawing disasters?" He was right. I was always drawing disasters. Trains crashing, native uprisings, volcanoes erupting, ships going down at sea. It was always disasters. Everything was a disaster. What had brought about these dark thoughts? But it was hardly surprising. We had just lived through 6 years of war, and disasters seemed to be everywhere, even in the relative calm of Kidderminster. One day, a boy at school told me he had seen a woman being murdered at a second-floor window. I didn't believe him. He took me to see the exact window. I still didn't believe him, but such was his zeal and conviction in putting his story across. I wasn't entirely sure. But I did see a poor man suffering an epileptic fit in an alleyway between gardens. As he shook and swayed, he held on to the railings with one hand, while the other let drop his morning's shopping, a paper packet from which a gleaming silver fish slipped onto the ground. I was too scared to help, but a kindly lady stepped in and picked up his fish. Around the same time, I saw a cat dart across the road. There was a thump as it was run over by a passing car. I saw the poor cat with a broken back trying to run crookedly to the pavement. A man hit it on its head with a walking stick. It ran into a wall and died there with its pink tongue lolling out. I often wonder if I've logged these images and unconsciously allowed them to influence my work. I suffered from the most horrific nightmares. Shouting and confused, half asleep and half awake, twisting and turning, My hands on the counterpane felt thick and swollen to an enormous size. I thrashed around, the blanket sweaty and tangled. I struck out with my legs, and once caught my grandmother, who was trying to quieten me, full in the chest. She reeled back and fell to the floor. I was at once asleep and awake at the same time. I was in a strange, heightened, lonely world. I could still see the room around me, but everything seemed a long way away. Sometimes, as though down a never-ending tunnel. It was very frightening. Could it have been the drugs? There is no record of what I was being prescribed at that time. A very large picture that hung over the fireplace in the bedroom didn't help. It looked creepy. It showed three monks in aprons carrying a large table laden with plates of food. One of the monks had three legs. I don't think it was intentional. The artist had repainted the leg he didn't like in a new position and had forgotten to take the old one out. I found it disturbing. Lying alone in the dark one night, I felt something walking across the counterpane. Panic swept over me. It felt like an animal. A cat? But we didn't have a cat, so it couldn't be. I shouted out in fear without daring to look. It was a witch's cat, I thought. Another nightmare? But no. It turned out it was a cat, looking up at me completely unaware of the terror it had inspired. How it got onto my bed and from where it came, I never knew. Probably because he was frequently away, when I saw him, my father seemed new to me. I didn't know him well. I think when he visited us in Kidderminster, my mother urged him to try to get to know me. One day I walked shyly hand in hand with my dad to nearby Hadley Valley for a drink at the Fountain Pub, where he had a half a bitter and I drank lemonade. It was slightly awkward, as though he didn't know what to say to me. Maybe being in the RAF had kept him away for a long time. My father was a gentle, rather shy man, and I was extremely fond of him. He was very kind to me. Some of my friends had pet white mice. They told me a shop in the Kidderminster Butts was selling them, so I went down there on my own and made my first ever purchase, buying the last white mouse in the shop for a shilling. I took it home. My mother and grandmother were a little nonplussed and irritated at first, but my father got to work, building it a little wooden cage with a door and a wire mesh front. There was a place for my mouse to sleep on one side and a place for her to walk about on the other. All went well for a while, and I would take out my little mouse with her pink eyes and let her explore my arm and the small area that was my room. We were both very happy. I became convinced my mouse was going to have babies. She was tearing up bits of paper and making a snug nest in her home. My mother patiently explained to me that you need a father mouse and a mother mouse to make babies. My first proper lesson in this unbelievable and puzzling concept. Surely that couldn't be right. The boys had told me about it at school, but I didn't believe it. Too surreal. I knew my parents hadn't done that. It was unthinkable. And as my mouse was shut up in her cage all the time, it was not possible anyway. But I remained convinced that my mouse was pregnant, and sure enough, she had a litter of small blind mice. Incontrovertible proof that you did not need a father and mother to make a baby. I later learned that it had not been an immaculate conception, and that somehow my mouse had been receiving a gentleman caller. I think my father's carpentry skills must have been a tad shoddy, and a common but bold brown house mouse had got into my pink-eyed lady's little house and had his wicked way with her. The next day, when I returned excitedly from school with friends to show off my baby mice, I found that my grandmother had drowned them all in a bucket of water. A cruel lesson in bereavement. I was devastated. She had been worried the house would be overrun with the creatures. Asthma continued to plague and attack me, though, as any person with a disability knows, one learns to live with it. Apart from crippling attacks, I was able to make my way wheezily through the day. One of the more bizarre, almost medieval, cures was thought to be having a hot poultice applied to my chest. It was said to draw out the bacteria. It is still used for horses. My parents announced that if I wished, I could spend the summer holidays with my paternal grandmother and grandfather in Twyford, near Reading. Initially, it was thought that getting away into the country air would do me and my asthma good, and indeed I think it did do me good, but not perhaps in that way. It was a relief to get away from my lonely life at home. It gave me a sense of freedom. My Aunt Mary and my cousins, Susan, Monica, Tim and Dick, would most likely be there, and we could play in the garden, roam the fields, go for walks, climb trees and ride our bikes along the unmade dirt roads with their enormous brown puddles at will. I loved every moment of it. Although Walt Disney was my biggest hero as a child, and I waited with excitement for any of his films to appear, my first artistic influence was my paternal grandfather. He was a magician with wood. It seemed he could transform it into anything he wished. His workshop in the garage was a child's delight. Racks of chisels, bradawls, planes and saws. Shelves with brightly coloured pots of paint and half-finished toys. And the floor covered with ankle-deep wood shavings. The smell of those shavings stays with me even now. He made toys for all his grandchildren. Most of all, I admired his model soldiers. Some were mounted and some were on foot. Hussars, lancers, horse guards and Coldstream guards, every detail carved and painted to perfection. When I was about 15, I copied him and made some myself. I still have them. My grandfather had been in the army and appeared to know every regiment, every rank and every uniform. Even late in his life, he had a military bearing with a very straight back and upright posture. He looked like the film star C. Aubrey Smith. He made toys for us children throughout the war. One Christmas, he made me a wooden machine gun with a metal attachment that made a chattering sound when I turned a little handle. It might not stand comparison with the computer games of today, but nevertheless, it carried its element of violence. My grandfather also kept chickens, and it was a treat to go down to the hen house at the bottom of the garden with him, opening the lids of laying boxes at the back, put my hand into the deep straw inside, and rummage around. The sensation of feeling warm, beautiful, brown or pearly white newly laid eggs nestled in the straw was wonderful. We would take them back to the house, where my grandmother would prepare fresh boiled eggs with buttered toast for the breakfast table. Much to my grandmother's distaste, my grandfather had a particular way of dealing with annoying flies. When one landed on the kitchen table, his hand would hover over the unsuspecting insect, merrily going about cleaning its black legs. Then, with a loud smack, he would hit the table. End a fly. Gotcha, he would say. My grandmother found this behaviour coarse and cruel. Oh, do stop that, she used to say. All the Scarfes had a great sense of humour. I asked my grandfather why the cockerel who serviced the hens ran in such a strange bandy-legged way with his legs so far apart. Well, he said, he used to run with them so close together that the friction caused them to catch fire, which he found uncomfortable. So now he runs like that to let the breeze blow through. I believed him. My grandfather worked in London, in the Commonwealth Bank of Australia. He would often bring me bundles of used envelopes that had been sent to the bank. I was an enthusiastic stamp collector and would steam the stamps from the envelopes and add them to my collection. They were often exotic and colourful and took me to faraway lands with wonderful names. Tanganyika, Ceylon, Samoa, Abyssinia. I had some very rare and unusual examples. A couple of penny blacks and others from Commonwealth countries with the king and queen on that I was told were valuable. There is a great deal of money in stamps, but unfortunately I later left my collection in a house I owned which was torn down. So in my case, philately didn't get me anywhere. I enjoyed digging holes, big, deep holes. I would take a spade from the garage, go down to the bottom of the garden, and dig a hole. I loved it. I'm not sure why. I told the adults I was digging for coal. They said they thought I was on my way to Australia. One day, I did unearth some shiny black coal. Too shiny, really. Something didn't seem quite right. I discovered later that one of my aunts had buried it there for me to find. In general, life at Twyford was idyllic. But every silver lining has a cloud. That cloud was my Uncle Bobby. I was about 8 years old when, as I walked to the top of the stairs one morning in the house in Twyford, I heard the raised voices of Aunt Mary and her husband Bobby arguing in their bedroom. That morning there had been great excitement, as Aunt Mary had suggested, as a rare treat, an outing to the cinema in Reading. Me, my cousins Tim and Dick, and Uncle Bobby and Aunt Mary. I heard Uncle Bobby shout, "We don't want that kid coming with us." As I stood on the landing outside their bedroom, I realised, with a frozen coldness creeping over me, that kid was me. Choking back my tears, I said, "It's all right, Aunt Mary, I'd rather stay here, don't worry." There was a prolonged silence from behind the door. I heard my aunt say, "You wretch, you wretch." Then coming out onto the landing, "Oh, darling, he didn't mean it." She put her arm around me. "Let's go downstairs." In floods of tears, I went downstairs. To cut a long story short, I did go to the pictures that afternoon to see Danny Kaye in Up in Arms, followed by tea and cakes. Looking back, it's hard to see how I could have gone anywhere with Uncle Bobby. But I was a young boy and was easily consoled and tricked by being given a real banana, a scarcity in those days, and also by the loving care of my aunt. But I never liked or trusted my uncle. He was, I learned later, generally disliked, and my aunt and he parted company some time later. By the way, I far preferred dried bananas to real ones, and dried eggs to real ones as well. After all, that's what I had been brought up on, thanks to wartime shortages and rationing. But mostly, they were hot, sunny, happy days in Twyford. Ronald, my youngest uncle, who was an officer in the British Army in Africa, and the most fun because he was the most irresponsible, visited often. He brought me presents of small ebony carved wooden figures, of African women with pendulous breasts, and silver metal necklaces and earrings made from fuse wire. One day he told me, indiscreetly, that African women were free and uninhibited. I didn't quite know what he meant, but I knew it was something saucy. He would take me into Henley for an afternoon at the pictures, driving too fast through the leafy sunlit lanes around Marlow in his open Riley sports car. Once, Uncle Ron and his friend Joe had to leave the cinema halfway through The Hound of the Baskervilles because Basil Rathbone scared me stiff. Joe wasn't at all pleased. Other days, we played darts on a dartboard behind the garage door. Uncle Jimmy, Uncle Ron's brother-in-law, was an Air Force pilot. He told us to stand in the garden at 12 o'clock one hot summer's day. We did as we were told, stood in the garden, and waited. Sure enough, at noon over the horizon came Uncle Jimmy's Spitfire at full throttle, missing our chimney pots by what seemed inches. Show off. It seems unimaginable with today's regulations, but it was wartime. What the hell? Uncle Jimmy was later killed in action. Life at Twyford seemed heavenly compared to London. I used to lie on my back in the long grass while butterflies danced around me and bees hummed and watched biplanes drone overhead leaving trails in the summer sky. With my cousins Tim and Dick, I made tunnels and pathways, crawling through the goldenrod, a perennial plant with bright yellow flowers which grew in profusion throughout the large garden. The air was clouded with pollen. I blamed the goldenrod for years, but I now know that it would have been the ragweed which frequently grows alongside it. Terrible asthma attacks followed, but no one seemed to make the connection. My grandparents and aunt were at a loss what to do. They put me, coughing and choking, to bed in a dark back bedroom. My biggest fear at the house in Twyford was a grimacing stuffed capuchin monkey who lived under a Victorian glass dome that stood on a dark brown chest of drawers in a corner. My Uncle Ron took it away. Happy summer holidays were also spent in Kington, Herefordshire, with my father's brother, Uncle Fred, and his wife, Aunt Clarice. I adored them both. They owned a riding school, and I learned to ride. My uncle nicknamed me Horseman. The horses were for hire, and at the end of each day, my older cousin, Susan, and I would ride the horses from the hotel, where the people who hired them were staying, back to the stables. Sue rode her horse, Sierra Sue, and I rode Ginger home at dusk along the lonely roads between the hedges with their dark and mysterious shapes and under the gaunt trees, their black twisted arms with clutching fingers stretching over our heads in the darkness. Although I was scared, it was an honour, and I felt grown up to be trusted to bring the horses back safely, but I was relieved when we reached the stables. My aunt, a countrywoman, told me she felt completely happy and safe walking through the country lanes after dark, but wouldn't dream of doing the same on the streets of London. I was also allowed to help shepherd sheep through the narrow lanes while standing on the running board of my uncle's old Austin 7. Occasionally, Uncle Fred would carry a couple of sheep inside the Austin 7 from one field he owned to another. They smelled a bit. Fish and chips afterwards, bought from the local shop. I was allowed to stay up late. So exciting. There were visits to the local flea pit cinema. Farm boys with their steaming boots up on the stove while Hopalong Cassidy galloped to the rescue. Then there was the horse show at the recreation ground. Champion show jumper Colonel Harry Llewellyn and his horse Fox Hunter were coming. Good days. Cyril, Aunt Clarice's Welsh brother-in-law, was a malicious little farmer who lived up in the Welsh hills. He didn't like me. I could feel it. When I was younger, he had menacingly suggested I go for a walk down by the river that ran through their land. I had a feeling he would like me to fall in. Another day, while he was up a ladder picking pears, he called me over and handed one down to me. As I grabbed it, my fingers sank into its soft flesh, and it seemed like 1,000 electric shocks pierced my hand. I screamed. He had given me a pear that had been half eaten away and was full of wasps. He grinned. Evil little Welsh bastard. I can still see that cruel grin today. Much later, I recall my mother saying, "Oh, you can't trust the Welsh." This seemed a sweeping statement, even though she had spent much of her young life in Wales. My knowledge of my mother's family is very scant. Only a few bits and pieces remain. Her brother, Douglas, had also been a teacher, but had always harboured an ambition to be a farmer. He eventually moved to Wales, where he had a farm at Llandudno on the north coast, with fields that ended at the cliff edge with sheer drops down to the Irish Sea. He was a bluff, straightforward character. I didn't see him very often, but I liked him. Notable for the amount of hair that came out of his ears, Uncle Doug also had the misfortune of backing his tractor and trailer over his wife, Dora, and disabling her for life. His son, my cousin, Kenneth Gardner, was a great authority in the field of Japanese historical bibliography and a distinguished historical librarian at the British Museum, and later the British Library. My mother also had an older sister, Sybil, who was a golf champion. Life in Kington was pretty slow. Every evening there was a gaggle of depressed-looking youths hanging around outside the brightly lit windows of the gas showrooms in the centre of town. In the early post-war years, there was no sign that they had any intention of building a new Britain. There was always a time lag between country and town. 20 years after Teddy Boys had long since disappeared from London, they still walked the streets of Kington like zombies. It was a time capsule. At the end of the town, where the road led to the next village, was an ancient stone bridge. At one end of the bridge was a small hexagonal building with a conical roof, maybe once a toll gate. My uncle often said he would like to turn this little tower into an ice cream kiosk. This was a very attractive idea to us children. We imagined how many free ice creams we would eat. But it went the way of many of my uncle's good ideas. It didn't come to pass. I spent many hours leaning over the parapet of the bridge with the warm sun on my back, gazing into the clear, shallow water of the river running below. So crystal clear, I could see the stony bottom, long, bright green strands of weeds waving lazily in the current. Little silver fish lurked among those undulating fronds. They were my prey. I slowly lowered my primitive fishing tackle into the water, near to where a small shoal of several dozen fish moved in unison. They flinched and darted away as one, in perfect formation. This was the general pattern. I had no success until one morning, at last, I caught one. I hauled it up to take out the hook and throw him back, as I had been taught to do. The hook had gone into his mouth, but had poked out through his eye. I was horrified. I made a mess of removing the hook. Poor fish. I threw him back all the same, and never went fishing again. Uncle Fred had a down-to-earth, no-nonsense attitude. He couldn't stand people who put on airs. He had been to Harrods, where he thought he would buy a beautiful figurine for my aunt. When he examined it, he discovered a small chip in the delicate porcelain. Because of this, he asked if he could have a reduction in the price. "Oh, no, sir. The snotty salesman snorted. This is Harrods. We don't do that sort of thing. Why not? Said Fred.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.